Just open the door for the people to come in.
Okay.
And let's see. The first ones are already there. Einen wunderschönen guten Abend zusammen. Ich habe gerade die Tür aufgemacht und schon öffnet sich, nein, schon füllt sich der Saal.
Die Deutschen sind immer sehr pünktlich.
Ja, ja, das ist, man merkt das. Das ist, ja, die haben echt vorne Schlange gestanden. Jetzt werden die Sitzplätze eingenommen. Aber bitte im gebührenden Abstand machen, wie Sie das gehört. Da legen wir ganz großen Wert drauf. Also jetzt Scherz beiseite. Wir freuen uns, dass ihr alle da seid. Seid nicht verwundert. Ihr seht uns, wir sehen euch nicht. Ihr seid alle in eurer Privatsphäre absolut geschützt. Euch kann nichts passieren. Wir sitzen hier an verschiedenen Stellen vom Priorat und in Spanien herum. Ehrlich zugegebenermaßen sitze ich leider jetzt gerade nicht mit dem leichten Sonnenuntergang im Priorat, sondern ich sitze zu Hause mit einem Greenscreen im Hintergrund, aber es sieht so einfach schöner aus, finde ich.
Ja.
Und wir zeichnen diese Session auf und werden auch gleich anfangen, das Ganze live auf Facebook zu streamen. Das haben wir noch nicht angemacht, das machen wir jetzt gleich, wenn wir loslegen. Wenn ihr Fragen stellen wollt, weil ihr könnt ja nicht reden, weil das Mikrofon, das Video ist abgestellt bei euch. Wenn ihr Fragen stellen wollt, dann könnt ihr das hier unten machen. Da seht ihr diesen Punkt F&A. Das steht für Fragen und Antworten. Da könnt ihr Fragen reinschreiben, die wir hier sehen. Ihr seht diese Fragen nicht. Wir sehen die Fragen aber. So kommt es, dass ihr sozusagen auch sogenannte dumme Fragen stellen könnt. Es gibt keine dummen Fragen, sondern wir sehen die Fragen und werden sie dann entweder am Ende oder zwischendrin beantworten können. Und dann ist unten noch die Chat-Funktion, wo ihr einfach ein kurzes Hallo reinrufen könnt oder ähnliches. Also da habt ihr verschiedene Möglichkeiten. Wir fangen jetzt erstmal einmal ganz kurz an, um so mit der Technik vertraut zu werden. Ich werde eine Umfrage starten, damit wir einfach so ein bisschen mehr wissen, wer ihr seid, von wo ihr kommt. Also diese Umfrage, ob ihr professionelle Teilnehmer seid oder private Weinliebhaber, aus welchem Bereich ihr kommt, mit wie vielen Personen ihr verkostet, ob ihr bereits Erfahrung mit Weinen aus dem Priorat habt oder und natürlich als vorletzte Frage, ob ihr Erfahrung mit den Weinen von Masdeutsch habt und zu guter Letzt, ob ihr mitverkostet, also ob ihr euch die Flaschen besorgt habt oder ob ihr trocken mitverkostet. Ich würde mich also freuen, wenn ihr diese Fragen kurz beantwortet und ich werde dann auch zum Schluss oder gleich, wenn die Beantwortung soweit durch ist, die Resultate mit euch teilen. Das Ganze ist natürlich anonym. Man sieht bloß, wie viel Prozent was gesagt haben. Man sieht nicht, wer was gesagt hat oder angeklickt hat. Ich sehe schon, jetzt kommen ganz kräftig die Antworten rein. Das ist super. Während ihr antwortet, kann ich schon mal die drei oder die beiden anderen Kollegen vorstellen, die mit dabei sind. Das ist da auf der einen Seite, jetzt gerade mit Glas in der Hand, das ist Valentin Llagostera, Chef von Dat Janssen von Masdeutsch. Mit ihm werden wir in Englisch sprechen, weil sein Deutsch ist minimal, genauso wie unser Katalan sehr schwierig ist. Wir werden dann halt immer wieder in Englisch umschwenken, wenn wir mit ihm reden. Great that you are with us, Valentin.
Thanks. Thanks all of you for attending this session. Hope we are going to enjoy the next hour just talking about Priorat and the wines.
Mm-hmm. Ja, das denke ich auch. Und mit dabei ist Christoph Schönegge, ein Diplom-Sommelier, der bei Deuner arbeitet seit wie vielen Jahren? Jahrzehnten?
Ja, 25 Jahren.
Seit 25 Jahren dabei, einfach um die Weine aus Spanien und Italien natürlich, die ihr vertreibt, nicht nur an den Mann zu bringen, sondern auch darüber zu informieren.
Richtig.
So, ich lasse jetzt mal die Umfrage noch einen ganz kleinen Moment laufen. Ich habe jetzt gesehen, einige haben auch so geantwortet, Weinhändler mitverkosten aus aus Sachsen, aber das finde ich super, dass wir auch wirklich so diese ganze Bandbreite haben. So, ich halte noch mal ganz kurz die Luft an, bevor ich jetzt die Umfrage beende, aber ich glaube, das passt jetzt soweit. Und dann werde ich auch gleich die Umfrage mit euch teilen. Also die Ergebnisse, ihr seht also, knapp die Hälfte der Teilnehmer sind aus dem Feld private Weinliebhaber, die andere Hälfte sind aus dem Bereich Freelancer, Profis aus dem Weingetränkehandel und auch aus der Gastronomie, Hotellerie, Catering. Größtenteils 70% verkosten alleine, aber auch einige mit 4 Leuten oder mit 2 Leuten. Keine Erfahrung mit Priorat hat gar keiner, das ist schon mal super. Einige Erfahrungen, 38%, das ist der höchste Wert, umfassende Erfahrungen sogar auch, ist natürlich klasse. Und gerade das freut mich, dass ihr dann zuschaltet. Ich denke, so ein direktes Gespräch, auch mit dem Winzer selber, mit dem Valentin, ist natürlich nochmal super spannend. Man kriegt ganz, ganz viel Hintergrundinformationen. 38% haben bislang keine Erfahrung mit Mastdeutsch, die werdet ihr heute bekommen. Etwas Erfahrung, einige Erfahrung, es wird um einiges mehr Erfahrung geben anschließend. Über 60%, also knapp, also gut über die Hälfte, schauen nur zu oder hören nur zu und sind nicht mit am Verkosten. Ihr werdet es etwas bereuen, aber wir werden natürlich auch viele Informationen mit euch teilen. Ihr könnt auch jederzeit anschließend nochmal die Weine nachverkosten und auch euch die Flaschen besorgen. Ich werde jetzt den Livestream starten, weil jetzt wird es dahingehend interessant. Ich muss jetzt noch mal ganz kurz gucken, bevor ich dann nämlich eine kurze Einführung mache in den Bereich Weinbau in Spanien und natürlich den Bereich Priorat, das Ganze etwas vorstellen, näher vorstellen, um einfach euch die Information zu geben, was alles möglich ist. Jetzt gucke ich. Christoph, siehst du es bei euch schon auf dem Monitor?
Läuft. Ja. Läuft.
Wunderbar. Das läuft. Sehr gut. Dann kann ich auch anfangen mit der Präsentation. Und dafür teile ich meinen Bildschirm mit euch. Ihr seht jetzt meinen Bildschirm, wo ich die Präsentation vorbereitet habe, die wir jetzt gemeinsam relativ kurz durchgehen werden, aber dort werden wir einige Sachen machen. Als erstes will ich natürlich das Land Spanien kurz vorstellen. Klar, ich meine, Spanien kennen wir alle. Parlamentarische Erbmonarchie, Hauptstadt Madrid, hier im Zentrum des Ganzen. Dann hier Barcelona, die 2. Millionenstadt, die einzig weitere Millionenstadt in Spanien. Ansonsten sind es kleinere Städte. Deutlich größer von der Fläche wie Deutschland, aber ja, knapp, also etwas mehr wie halb so viele Einwohner. Also man hat deutlich weniger Einwohner pro Quadratkilometer, wie wir es hier eben doch im Großen und Ganzen dicht besiedelt in Deutschland haben. Zum Beispiel zumindest hier im Rhein-Ruhr-Gebiet ist es ja sehr dicht besiedelt. Aber klar gibt es hier auch eher ländliche Regionen. Viel wichtiger ist die Topografie, die Geografie, um Spanien zu verstehen. Die Meseta, also dieser Bereich in der Mitte, das ist eigentlich so der Kernbereich von Spanien. Das ist ein Hochplateau auf einer Höhe von 500 Metern und dann nochmal hier durchschnitten vom kastilischen Scheidegebirge. Aber diese ganzen Gebirge werde ich jetzt kurz vorstellen. Wir haben einmal das Iberische Randgebirge, dann haben wir dieses kastilische Scheidegebirge, was ich gerade schon angesprochen habe. Und man sieht, das geht auf knapp 2600 Metern. Da kann man wirklich Gebirge sagen. Für die Madrileños, also die Einwohner von Madrid, ist es auch wirklich eine ganz beliebte Kurzurlaubsregion. Viele haben, also wohlhabendere Leute haben dort auch ihre Sommerhäuser oder gehen dort Skifahren. Das ist wirklich eine tolle Skilocation auch. Dann haben wir das kantabrische Küstengebirge mit über 2600 Meter Höhe, wo auch die Picos de Europa mit dabei sind. Dann haben wir die Pyrenäen, also die Grenze zu Frankreich mit 3400 Metern und die höchste Erhebung auf dem spanischen Festland mit 3478 Metern ist die Sierra Nevada. Also da kann es einem passieren, dass man hier unten in Granada ist, so im Juli, August und oben auf den Berggipfeln immer noch Schnee sieht. Das Interessante ist, Spanien ist mit 660 Metern Durchschnittshöhe das zweithöchste Land Europas. Das ist etwas, was viele Leute so gar nicht auf dem Bildschirm haben. Das Ganze beeinflusst natürlich auch massiv das Klima. weil die Bergketten, die schirmen natürlich diese Meseta ab vor den kalten Winden, vor den feuchten Winden hier oben von der Biscaya beispielsweise. Hier oben haben wir sehr hohe Niederschläge in den Küstengebirgen, weil die aufsteigenden Winde vom Atlantik kühlen sich ab und regnen sich ab. Also hier haben wir 1500, 1600 Millimeter Niederschlag ohne weiteres. Und dann fährt man mal 50, 60 Kilometer einfach mal über die Berge und dann geht es runter auf 400 Millimeter, 500 Millimeter. Wichtig ist aber auch der Faktor Höhe hier im zentralen Bereich, weil die sehr niedrigen Nachttemperaturen die Hitze des Tages eigentlich sehr schön abpuffern. Und durch diese Berge und alles haben wir auch eine Vielfalt von klimatisch beeinflussten Weinstilen. Ganz kurz nochmal so ein bisschen die Klimagebiete. Wir haben hier dieses klassische atlantische Klima mit milden Temperaturen und hohen Niederschlägen. Dann im Zentrum das kontinentale Klima, große Temperaturamplitude von Tag zu Nacht, von Sommer und Winter. Also es geht wirklich im Sommer hoch bis auf 30, 35, 40 Grad. Im Winter geht es runter auf minus 10, minus 15 Grad. Es kann aber auch tagsüber 35 Grad haben und nachts wird es dann eben mal 15 Grad. Also es ist schon enorm. Dann haben wir hier diesen relativ schmalen Streifen nur des mediterranen Klimas, also warme Sommer, milde Winter, der sich dann aber hier nochmal über das Ebro-Tal, über diesen Klimakorridor ins Landesinnere zieht. Und dann die heißeste Region hier unten, das Delta des Guadalquivir, wo es dann auch mal im Sommer über 47 Grad warm werden kann. Zum Weinbau in Spanien ein paar Worte. Weltweit immer noch die größte Rebfläche. Wir sprechen über knapp 960.000 Hektar. Im Vergleich dazu, Deutschland hat 102.000 Hektar. Also man kann Pi mal Daumen sagen, das Zehnfache der deutschen Rebfläche ist in Spanien zu finden. 42 Landweingebiete, 96 Qualitätsweinbaugebiete, die sich nur untergliedern. In, ja, das bekannteste sind eigentlich hier diese DOs, Denominación de Origen. Dann gibt es zwei DOCs, oder in dem Fall von Priorat ist es DOQ. Das ist also einmal Rioja und einmal Priorat. Das sind die beiden höchstklassifizierten. Es gibt 19 Vino de Pago-Klassifikationen, also das ist ein Weingut mit der eigenen Klassifikation. Und in Katalonien gibt es diese Vide Fincas. Das ist eine etwas neuere Gesetzgebung, auf die komme ich gleich noch mal zu sprechen. Aber man sieht eigentlich hier auf der Karte sehr schön, der Weinbau erstreckt sich quer durch Spanien, also eigentlich auf allen, fast in allen Landesteilen. Von den Rebsorten her, das ist immer wieder verwunderlich, dass etwa die Hälfte der Rebsorten weiße Rebsorten sind, die andere Hälfte sind rote Rebsorten, knapp 180 Rebsorten sind registriert und in Produktion. Aber es gab einen grundlegenden Wandel in den letzten 25 Jahren. Auf der einen Seite von geänderten Konsumgewohnheiten, aber auch von neuen Kellertechniken. Die Verbreitung der internationalen Rebsorten, also Chardonnay, Cabernet Sauvignon, Syrah, liegt immer noch unter 10% der Gesamtrebfläche. Es mag einem manchmal etwas mehr vorkommen, weil wir auf den Etiketten der Qualitätsweine öfter mal Cabernet und Ähnliches sehen, aber in der Gesamtmenge ist es doch relativ wenig immer noch. Jetzt kommen wir schnell noch ins Priorat, einfach damit man mal versteht, wo das ist. Es gehört zu Katalonien. Hier ist jetzt eingezeichnet, das ist Katalonien. Also hier oben haben wir die Grenze zu Frankreich. Hier ist es Mittelmeer und da geht es dann sozusagen ins Landesinnere. Hier Hauptstadt von Katalonien, Barcelona. Priorat an sich, genau, da kann man jetzt auch sehen, wo das Priorat ist, von Barcelona, die Küste etwas weiter runtergefahren, an Tarragona vorbei, abbiegen ins Landesinnere, da kommt man hier ins Priorat. Hier auf dem nächsten Bild sieht man es nochmal etwas besser, das ist also das Priorat in seiner Grundform. 2000 Hektar, also gar nicht mal so groß, aber wenn man denkt, vor 20 Jahren, also wirklich vor genau 20 Jahren waren es 890 Hektar, weil die Region hat in den Zeiten hat sie ganz, ganz viel Rebfläche verloren, bis sie dann halt vor Mitte der 90er Jahre wiederentdeckt worden ist und dann seitdem wieder gewachsen ist, als eine der Top-Weinregionen Spaniens. Es ist mediterranes Klima, weil wir haben ja hier dann doch relativ nah die Küste, aber mit einem deutlichen kontinentalen Einfluss, weil wir natürlich schon in die Berge hochgehen. Wir sehen ja auch die Höhe, 100 Meter unten in den Tälern, 750 Metern, in den Höhenlagen die Weinberge. Die Berge an sich gehen nochmal ein gutes Stück höher. Böden sind vor allem Licorella Schiefer. Da kommen wir gleich nochmal weiter zu. Hauptrebsorten ist Garnacha, also Grenache, und Carignana. Das sind die beiden Hauptrebsorten. Und hier kommen wir nochmal zu diesen 2009 eingeführten Vins de Vila, also die Ortsweine. Hier sieht man auch eingezeichnet diese leichten Umrisse. Das sind die Regionen, wo diese Ortsweine herkommen dürfen. Und seit 2006 die Vins de Finca, also wirklich, ja, man kann fast sagen Lagenweine. Das ist etwas, was relativ neu dazugekommen ist. Zu den Böden. Hier unten im Bild sieht man Licorella Schiefer, ist also ein sehr kleinblättriger Schiefer, der fein aufblättert, der leicht zerbricht. Und alles, was hier auf der Karte in hellblau, hellgrün und rot ist, also hier dieser ganze innere Bereich, hellblau, hellgrün und rot, das ist alles Licorella Schiefer aus verschiedenen Zeiten, also einmal aus der devonischen Zeit und so weiter. Das kann man hier eigentlich sehr schön sehen und auch mit den entsprechenden Orten mit dabei eingezeichnet. Und der Monsanto, das Gebirge, das ist hier oben angesiedelt. Das ist also, daher ist dort auch der Boden nochmal etwas anders. Zu den Rebsorten noch in Kürze. Wichtigste Rebsorten sind Garnacha und Carignana. Garnacha in Katalan, man sieht es auch oft auf dem Etikett, steht da Garnacha mit X geschrieben, aber das ist halt Katalan. Katalan ist eine eigene Sprache. Also es ist kein Dialekt, sondern wenn wir über die Sprache Spanisch reden, dann reden wir eigentlich über Castellano. Und Katalan ist eine eigene Sprache, die auch für einen Spanier oftmals gar nicht wirklich verständlich ist, weil sie, ich sag mal, recht eigen ist. In Französisch würde es Grenache heißen. Sehr stark im mediterranen Bereich vertreten. Das ist eigentlich die Hauptregion, wo die Rebsorte herkommt. Und das Schöne am Grenache ist, oder am Garnacha, dass sie den Terroir-Charakter extrem gut widerspiegelt. Und jetzt auch in den letzten Jahren eine Renaissance erlebt. Es war auch eine Zeit lang die meist angebaute Rebsorte in Spanien. Rote Rebsorte, sorry. Nicht bei den Weißen. Carignana, auch hier wieder eine etwas andere Schreibweise im Katalanischen. Oder Carignan, was man ja auch von der Rhone kennt, wo ja auch der Grenache angebaut wird, im französischen Bereich. Vor allem in Katalonien anzutreffen, im Ebro-Tal. In der Rioja heißt die Rebsorte dann Mazuelo. Und die bringt vor allem dieses robuste Tanningerüst und eine prägnante Säure in die Weine. Die beiden Rebsorten müssen entweder als Solist oder auch als Cuvée mindestens 60% eines Rotweins aus dem Priorat ausmachen. Also diese beiden Rebsorten oder eine von den beiden Rebsorten ist immer ein dominanter Faktor in den Weinen aus dem Priorat. Jetzt kommen wir noch schnell zu einem Mastdeutsch, einfach so ein erster Eindruck. Ihr seht, mein Hintergrundbild ist jetzt hier auch nochmal zu sehen. Das ist die Kellerei. Ich habe mich also virtuell vor die Kellerei gesetzt. Es wurde 1998 gegründet, der Cellar Mastdeutsch. Aber es ist letztendlich kein neues Weingut, sondern es ist eine Wiederaufnahme einer Tradition, die 1850 schon begonnen hat. Die Weinberge wurden nach der Reblauskrise neu bepflanzt, also Anfang des 20. Jahrhunderts. Aber die Trauben wurden dann halt für Jahrzehnte an die Genossenschaft in Poboleda geliefert, bis dann 1998 mit der eigenen Kellerei wieder die eigenen Trauben auch selber verarbeitet worden sind. Und damit ihr nochmal kurz seht, wo jetzt wirklich das die Kellerei ist, das ist jetzt mal so eine Karte, wo man sehr schön sieht, wie hügelig eigentlich die Region ist. Diese ganzen feinen Striche, dort sind Höhenlinien und hier sieht man dann auch, dort ist Mastdeutsch, also im Nordosten des Priorats, in der Nähe des Monsantgebirges. Hier oben sieht man ja auch schon mal die erste große Kante, da geht es dann hoch zum Monsantgebirge. Und hier schlängelt sich dann durch das Siurana-Tal. Nochmal ein etwas anderer Blick. Hier sieht man eigentlich sehr schön nochmal die Kellerei und im Hintergrund dieses doch sehr harte, sehr schroffe Monsantgebirge. Das ist eigentlich nochmal auch ein sehr schöner Blick, um die Region zu verstehen. Das sollte jetzt einfach mal als kurze Einführung des Ganzen reichen, denke ich. Und jetzt wollen wir anfangen, uns mit Valentin zu unterhalten, auch über die Weine. Und dafür wird Valentin etwas Yes, you are now free to show your screen and show us a little bit about the winery.
Okay.
Yes, we see your screen. So very welcome, Valenti.
Okay.
And we are very happy that you're with us.
Thank you very much. Thank you for welcoming me and thanks for having this time to share with you some input and some info about the global view you have done on Spain and how different the wines may be in our country. And then going now to Mas Doja within this very tiny area of the Priorat. It's for me a pleasure to be able to share with you. Please feel free to make any question about our place and about our wines during my speech. Well, Mas Doja, just going direct, as you see, last year we were just celebrating our 20th anniversary, 20 years, which in the wine industry is not that much. However, in the Priorat, is very much related with the youth of our place. I mean, in Priorat, we have been planting vines for the last 1,000 years, but just for the last 30, we have been elaborating in a rather fine way. Then the point here would be to talk about the sense of purpose. And the idea to show you this would be my family, my father's family is coming from this village of Poboleda. My father already went to live to Barcelona to work. I was born in Barcelona, but always coming back to this area of the Priorat for harvest with my cousins that remain in this very tiny village and one uncle who planted some vines at the very beginning of the 20th century in 1902, just after the phylloxera. For many, many years, all those grapes were going to the cooperativa. When I was a kid, I was coming here just for the harvest, as you see here in these images, and all the grapes were just being gone to the cooperativa. And then it was in the mid-90s, when I was just coming back with my children for harvest, when after 3 years of staking the grapes of these vineyards you have seen and going to the COP, that just coming back to Barcelona, I just talked with me and my wife in the car. I said, why not could we ask our cousins just to keep the grapes at home and just to begin to elaborate? And that's how Mas Doja was created in 98. And that's how we just began in 99 with our very first vintage. Here you see this Montsant mountain, which as you will see, we are going to talk about it later. Poboleda is a tiny place in the northeast part of it. Today we have something like 300 people living there. And before phylloxera, it's at the end of the 19th century, almost 2,400 people was living there. The whole of the place was completely planted. Just one word about the name, Priorat. Priorat means the land of the priory. All this area was given to the Cartusian monks at the very end of the 11th century. And for 600 years, 3,000 hectares that were the place of the monks brought us all the knowledge, the varieties. They were coming from Provence. And at that time, they just began to plant in our place. Clearly, they could knew that because of the soil, because of the climate, this could be a good place for that. And since then, the only thing that has been really important in the Priorat area has been vines that has been there for the last 1,000 years. Then the sense of purpose of Mas Doja, I would say it's just threefold. The first would be to preserve the way of life. When I was coming back in the night, mid-90s to Poboleda, and I see the village, I see that nothing was going on. I thought that just elaborating and just retaking the vineyard and to elaborate wine was the way to preserve the way of life of this area. Secondly, it was clear that we had to take advantage of these grapes coming from these vines planted in 1902 that were going just directly to the cup to be blended with whatever was coming in. And third, for sure, just to elaborate from that point distinctive Priorat wines. Since then, we have been not only getting more all vineyards from people from our village of Poboleda, but also planting new places, as the ones you see here in this picture, which is a new young Garnacha Blanca. We have also been planting Garnacha Blanca and Macabeu because white wines have becoming really important in the Priorat in the last 5-7 years. And this is the winery that it was ready to be inaugurated for Easter this year, but well, we have to wait just because of the situation. But we in Priorat, I'd like to say that we are ready to be patient. We have been there for many years without many things not going on, and we are ready to wait. And we are sure that from next July on, we are going to receive people and coming to visit us. And this is the new winery just set up at the very top of a very nice vineyard with an incredible view on the Montsant mountain, which is very close to our place. Well, this is a nice photo, just one. It's nice because you see the soil, what Pierre was just explaining you, this schist, this licorella. The whole of the winery has been covered with licorella that we have been taken from the big hole where the winery is just built. And in the glasses, you see the reflect of this Montsant, which is for Poboleda one of the most important things in terms of our location. Yeah. This is a nice picture just to show what you could be seeing from our winery when the sun sets in Priorat any day. Eh? You are invited to come to see this with us. Just two words about the sense of place, the terroir, where we are. We are in the Priorat. Here, as it was said, we are in Poboleda. Poboleda, as you see in the map, is in the northeast part of the Priorat, which means globally, and we will see later, a fresher side of it. We are called Poboleda la Frescal. On the one hand, we are just covered by this Montsant range, this big mountain, and just on the Siurana River, which is giving us also a very nice freshness. Just one point here to be comment. If you look at this map, you see how the Priorat is just hundreds of very small mountains, no? Then it depends on the altitude. It depends on the degree, let's say, of the mountain. It depends if you are in the valley, if you are in the top, that there are many, many different places. And as a matter of fact, when you were looking at the Schiffer situation, the point to be done is that the difference between the different villages in the Priorat are not mainly because of the soil, because it's all about Schiffer, but mainly about the different microclimates that we may have in the different villages within the Priorat. Just two words about the soil. It's this Schiffer. Here on the left, you see where we plant. Well, this is a pure rock. This is on a metamorphotic process from 300 to 400 million years soil, and easy to see here that there is almost no organic material. It's just a 2%. Then when we plant here, we have to make a hole on the rock, and then the roots have to grow through the fissures of this laminated slate, just going down looking for something to fit the grape, to fit the plant. Then very first and very important characteristic, very poor soil, very rocky, with almost no organic material. On the other hand, this soil, as you see, it's sort of a dark soil, it retains the heat. Then this means that in summertime, during the ripening process, this, just to give it to you now the info, this soil, you can get up to 65, 70 degrees. Okay, you cannot stand your hand on the schist 15 August at 3 o'clock because it's too hot. Then the soil retains the heat, and the other main characteristic, no way to retain the water. Then when it rains, which is not that usual, not this year, 2020, that it has really, 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 really rainy, water drains through the fissures of the slate, and there is no way to retain water. And then the roots have to go just through the fissures, just getting some humidity close to feed the grape. Then this pure rock, no organic material, retains heat, not retains water, very, very tough for the vine just to get something to feed the grape. Easy to understand, very low yields, but on the other hand, with rather high concentrations. On the side of here on your right, you see another very important thing. We have always traditionally been planting on a bush bind style, and you see the grape is very close to the soil. This is important on the ripening moment on summertime, because as I told you, this chest retains heat, and then during the day and during the night, temperatures may go down, as we will see, but it is still keeping some heat because of this very close soil to the grape. About the geological map we have already been looking at, is this common schist all around the place. And concerning climate, the main point is that you see in the maps that Pierre show you, we are in the Mediterranean. I mean, we would be Mediterranean days, 2,700 hours sun, but because of surrounded by big mountains, we do have what I call continental nights, which means that 15 August during the day, you may be easy to 40 degrees. It would be the picture on the bottom here on the left. 3 o'clock day, 40 degrees, but 3 o'clock night, the same day, this goes down to 16 degrees. This huge span of temperature, this is key for the Priorat, for our grapes, because this means sort of a stop and go ripening process. And this stop and go makes very long process of maturation, which means very good structure, but the most important thing, it retains the acidity. And then we are going to find how our wines, beside that rather high degree of sugar, which means high alcohol, has also very, very nice freshness. In terms of climate here, four pictures of our places. On the right, up right, you see winter time. We do have snow. This may happen every 3-4 years. This year in 2020, we had the snow at the very top of the Montsant for almost 1 week. But then as you see, we have some sort of continental winters, very, very cold. And very, very hot and very cold in the very place. And autumns, the bottom on the right, we are in Mediterranean. It's mainly rainy season from mid-September on, which for us is a very tough moment because it's also the moment that we do normally begin harvest, always the very beginning, if not mid-September. Then in terms of how this location is affecting in terms of the vintages, let me show you here one graph of 2018 vintage. Here you have three lines, okay? The very first to see is the green line. And the green is the temperature in the Priorat for the last 10 years average. This is the green line, okay? Then you have the orange, which is the temperature, the average temperature in the Priorat in 2018. And then if you look 2018, you see that from February, we do have a fresher climate than the average up to beginning May, which then it goes up. Then as it's very usual now, June, July, August, it's hotter than usual. And it's then in beginning October that the temperature goes down again. But if you look at the yellow line, this is the Poboleda average temperature. And then as you see, in Poboleda we are almost 1.5, if not 2 degrees lower than the Priorat average. As I told you, we are in this northeast side, which is fresher than the average. And in terms of rainy, we do have normally a 20% more of rain in our place. Yes, continue. This would be just in terms of vintages, the Winkler that is giving us the how hot is the year. And then we see in this case how 2017 was one of the hottest we have had. It's one of the wines we are going to taste. And in terms of rain, just different vintages here. The average, once again, is the blue here. And you see that we have had very dry years, the late 17. And 19. However, 18, a lot of rain, and 20 is still more rain than the one you are looking at this graph. At this point, I mean, at mid-June this year in Poboleda, we have received 7 times more rain than last year, to give you an idea. 7 times, one of the rainiest years we have ever had. 2 words about the varieties. Cariñena on the left, Garnacha on the right. The Cariñena, as you see, has this nice leaf that I look, it's sort of an open hand. You can look like this. The old vineyards, both varieties, were always planted in the same place. Eh? People thought that it was much better for the pollinization of the plant. But the tradition, because of the monks, that was everything was just a harvest at the same time. And Garnacha, it's more of a close-hand leaf. Eh? But as it was mentioned, very completely different varieties. Garnacha, both very Mediterranean, very well adapted to the heat, to the dry climates. However, Garnacha is giving us a lot of sugar, but medium tannins, medium acidity, while Carignana, it's giving some sort of a medium sugar, but high tannins and high acidity. So, and big color, right? The color is mainly coming from the skin of the Carignana. It's the blend of these two varieties that it's giving really the capacity to make long aging wines, which is the case in Mas Dos. How do we work? Eh? The sense of work, it's about sustainability today. Eh? I like to say that we like to take care of the vineyard. We are just taking care of these vines during the whole year, taking care of them. We have been, we received the organic certification in 2016. We were working before on that, but just to take the certification was taking a lot of papers and a lot of time. But finally, we get it, and since then, we have always been working like this. Everything, as you may see here, may be done by hand. Because of our location, the Priorat, it was planted just before phylloxera, but today is just 2,000 hectares planted, which is not even a 15% of our land, which means that we do have 85% of completely abandoned land that was planted 110 years ago, but not now. And in this sense, I mean, one of the main things now for us is just to preserve this biodiversity and just to keep this this very important environment around our vineyards as the one you see here. No?
Valentin, just a short break. When I visited the region of Priorat, I have often seen even in the woods that they are, let's say, terraces from former vineyards.
Yes, that's right. I mean, here, as you see, here, you see, I mean, these are very, very old terraces. These terraces were done, at the very beginning of the 20th century. And this keeps the Coste line, the steep vineyard. It's just this terrace done by rocks. The new plantations, people that has been planting since this new consumption of Priorat beginning 90s, instead of keeping the terraces, they have been doing by terraces because it's much easier to work. And then they are planting two lines of vines in the terrace, and you can work with the machine through that place. But in any case, in our case, even the new plantations are being done with the Coste. If you want, we can talk about this later because it keeps We think it keeps not only better quality, but also more homogeneous quality about the grapes you are getting from the vineyard. Any other question, Pierre?
No, not for the moment yet.
Okay, then here, as you see, we harvest by hand. I mean, we very first control at the vineyard, just taking the grapes that are okay, and when we get to the winery, we de-esteem in our case 100% of the grapes, and it's after de-esteeming that we do have a big table where, for people, we are just selecting on a berry by berry basis anything that is not completely 100% perfect. Let me put it this way: I mean, it's in the Priorat, it's rather easy to have overripe grapes, which looks nice, but we know how to identify, and we know that any overripe grape within a bottle, it may be okay for the first 3, 4, 5 years, but when you are just oriented to make long-lasting wines, overripe grapes gives you, I mean, does not give you any result. Then for us, one of the key issues is just to keep this nice freshness in our wines, this lively life, and it's key for us just to select the best grapes just to get within the bottle, either for Las Crestas, Salanques, Dos, or whatever the wine we are dealing with. As far as because we are working with these Costes, we have been able to retake some of the very old professions in the Priorat, which was just to work with the mull. Yeah, I mean, for the last 5, 6 years, a number of wineries we have asked, and now there is already guys in the Priorat that had take a salary of just working with the mull in this coast state where there is no way to work as a, on a terrace, and the only thing with which you can work and make a sort of a 40 centimeters path to work and to plant is with the mule that today is becoming a new partner with us in the place. Here you see Gita, with which we have been working for the last 4 years in our new plantations, and also working in the very old vineyards that it's helping us to work there. Well, just to show you here our team, we have a small team of really engaged people. Suli, we're coming from Ghana. The main work to be done is in the vineyard, I have to tell you. I mean, it's all about the vine, it's all about the grapes. And what we do take, we take care of just taking the best grapes within the winery. And just once we are in the winery, it's just about the minimum manipulation just to keep the fruit, which is the most important thing. Here on the left side, you see our harvest team last year, which was the very first harvest in the new winery. Just the part of the winery was done, not the offices and tasting rooms and all that. And this is our team of harvest. And here on the right, I am together with my Ramon, my brother Ramon, with which we founded Mas Dois already 21 years ago. And all this, let me put it this way, is because of enjoyment. I mean, it's about enjoyment, about taking a good enjoyment just drinking the wines. Then here, just one explanation to understand the different wines we do have. We have, if you see in the list on the right, Murmuri, which is our white, Las Crestas, is wine that we are going to taste today, Salanques, Dos 1902, 1903. The point is that if you look at the picture on the left, it's easy to understand that older the vine, longer the root growing through these fissures, okay? Then it's easy to explain that older the vine, longer the root, lower the yield, but higher the quality of the grape. Then higher the quality of the grape, it will be more complex the aromas, it will be longer the flavors, and better the texture of the wines, okay? Then tasting Las Crestas, in Las Crestas we are working with grapes coming from 20-year-old vines, which is roots of 5 meters and 1 kilo of grapes per vine. Salanques is already 60 to 80-year-old vines. These are means roots of 10 meters going down through these fissures. We get half kilo of grapes per vine. And Dos is already 100-year-old vines, 15 to 18 meters roots going through this Licorella soil. At the end, I can assure you, these are very, very thin roots, just getting the humidity that is just kept on these fissures. I mean, in the Priorat, if you ever come to meet us, you will see that there are no houses in the vineyard because there is no way to live, because there is no way to find water. However, this humidity, you may find this moisture, these small drops of water in these fissures going down. These breaks, I didn't mention, because on winter time, as you saw it, we do have snow. If we do not have snow, it's very, very cold during the night. Then drops of water just go down, it freezes, and it breaks. And as far as it breaks, the root has the capacity to go down. Without this mechanism, it would be impossible even to plant these vines, which, on the other hand, is the only crop available to dig in this very, very tough soil. Okay, then the second element, just to go on with our wines, is very much related with the different coupage. Then here you have a graph, you have Grenache on the vertical and Carignana here on the horizontal. From young vines here on the zero to very old vines for the Carignana. Yeah? Then the point is Crestas, which is our first red wine, is 80% of young Garnacha, 20 years old, 20 is young for us, and a 10% old Carignana. And as far as we are going today, Salanques and Dos, you have less Garnacha and more older Carignana. What does this mean? When you get more Carignana, you are getting more structure, more backbone, more acidity, more length, more verticality, while Garnacha is more about the fruit, it's more about the fruitness of the wine, giving a different, completely texture to the wine. Then as far as we will go from Crestas to Salanques and Dos, more Carignana, wider, longer, deeper wines. Well, it's all about...
Valentin, You explained about the temperature of Pupolida and Priorat. So you started the harvest later in Priorat than the other one, or were they different?
Yes, and yes, this is a good point, Christoph. Because of our fresher climate, we do begin between 1 week and 10 days later than in Gratellops or Bellmunt, which in the map that Pierre showed you are in the southern part.
I mean, it's not too far.
Yeah, and it's just 20 kilometers difference, but in this 20 kilometers, just to give you an idea, we are beginning regularly 1 week or 10 days later the harvest of the same type of grapes. Just to give you the idea of how different is the climate between the different villages.
Thank you.
Gut. Ich finde es auch ganz spannend, in Deutschland ist es legal, auf eine Flasche Wein draufzuschreiben, alte Reben, wenn die Reben 25 Jahre alt sind. Und wir sehen hier, die schreiben junge Reben bei 20 bis 25 Jahren. Da sieht man einfach mal, wie der Unterschied ist. I just explained that in Germany it's legally okay to write old vines if the vines have 25 years.
Yeah.
And for you, 25-year-old vines, that's your vinos jóvenes.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, in our case, for us, these are our young vines. However, it's true that, I mean, in terms of the Priorat, people is now elaborating wines with garnaches of 5 to 8 years. Yeah, I mean, it's. However, one of the main objectives when we just began to elaborate is just to keep the real Priorat idea about wine. And Priorat wines, from the very beginning, have always sort of a dark, powerful wines to be aged. And then instead of doing sort of a, there are, let me put it this way, there are many other places in Spain where you can get easy and nice young Garnacha. Eh? In Priorat, we do think that we have to take advantage of our these very special conditions to make these very special wines at the same time. Yeah. Okay.
Good.
Okay, well then, the point is that for the tasting,
eine kurze Break. Gibt es irgendwelche Fragen? Also es ist jederzeit möglich, irgendwie Fragen zu stellen oder Informationen zu bekommen über die Weine, jederzeit über den Punkt Q&A oder Frage und Antwort.
Antworten. Da kommt direkt auch eine rein. Reagieren Sie mittel- und langfristig auf den Klimawandel? Oh, das ist eine sehr gute Frage. Höhere Temperaturen gleich höhere Alkoholgehalte, gleich Zuckergehalte gleich höhere Alkohole. Valentin, there's a very good question coming in from Wilfried. Yes. In how far you are reacting or you have to react in relationship to the change of climate? Because with higher temperatures, you have more sugars, and more sugars is more alcohol in the end.
Yeah. Yes. At this point, let me put it this way, we have decided a heat wave we had last June, 2019, where we reached 42 degrees. Clearly, now water is becoming our more scarce and more valuable thing just to keep mainly young vines alive, okay? We have seen how in the last vintages we are getting sort of a much more variability of temperatures. Eh? I mean, the curve of the temperature, it's getting sort of a more vertical instead of getting flatter, it's getting more vertical. And this means that the way it's affecting us, we have to be very, very close to the ripening process and to the harvesting decisions moment. Then, for the moment, I could say that for the last 20 years, now we are harvesting average 1 week later than it was 20 years ago, on the one hand. And the point is that we have to keep not the sugar that for us, because of our place, because of the sun, is not a big problem, but about the phenolic ripening of the grape. I mean, what is going on with the skin and with the seed. And that's for us the very important point to follow. Then, beside these two elements, also the fact that in the last 5 years, two of them, 2017 was the more clear case, very young mind, we had and we are allowed now just to put some water on it. I mean, to irrigate. Irrigate in the Priorat means to make a hole just beside the vine and to put two liters of water just within, because people that has been trying to make some sort of a drop by drop system, when the drop is just going down in the Priorat, half of the water evaporates, and yeah. When it touches the Licorella, which is at 50 or 60 degrees average during summer, just do not get any water. Then the only way is just to put the water within the soil, just to keep the humidity for the vine to develop. Yeah. Another fact that today is going on in the Priorat is, for instance, any vineyard we have been planting with any new white Garnacha, we have been looking for northeast orientation places, which were not the case in Priorat. I mean, people traditionally was planting in southwest because people were just paying the sugar, it was paying the degree. I mean, traditionally Priorat, the bulk wine had 17, 18 degrees alcohol because it was sold just to be blended with other wines. That was the, how was the Priorat has been surviving the 20th century before René Barbier and other people came and began to elaborate other wines. Yeah.
I think this point to just go on the cooler side of the mountains is very important. And this is also, Wilfried was saying if in how far you might even make some shades on the vineyard, but in the end, going to the other side of the sun direction, you are giving them the shade.
Yeah. Yes, not only this, we are working a lot now with the canopy. I mean, with how the shade is given by the leaves, but you have also to, and this is something I did not mention, the schist has still a third completely important characteristic, which is no organic material, it retains heat, does not retain water, but it shines. It has mica on it, and then as a matter of fact, if you ever come to visit us, the sun reflects on the schist and goes up to the grape again. I mean, the grape do receive the sun directly and also through the reflection through the soil, yeah, which is still another very important point of this schist we have in our place. Yeah.
Would it be a possibility to plant trees or other things?
For the moment, no. I mean, here the point, as I told you, the only crop, I mean, in the Priorat, either we plant vines or there is no other thing to be planted. I mean, yes. All these trees you see here, this has been growing for the last 110 years. And that's all. I mean, we do not have, you don't have any water. I mean, there is no way to plant any cereal, any fruit, any, we do not have any cows, any, because there is no hierbas, there is no herbs, mm-hmm. Nothing. Yeah? Then just to think about planting trees just to give shade, it makes no sense in our place. No?
Yeah.
Here, what we have to do is just to see and to work with the plant. I mean, there is no other way. I mean, it's the way here. What we see, let me put it this way, is that when you work with these very old vines, is what I call them, I do not call them very old vines, but wise vines. Why? Because they know how to manage. They give us just 300 grams of grapes, completely perfect quality, on, and they are very, very consistent. Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the best things to be done when we taste our verticals is that we are very consistent, even taking into account the difference of the vintages, because these very old vines have such long roots that they are always providing very consistent grapes. This is a very important characteristic for us.
Okay. So let's move on to the wines.
Let's go to the wines. Okay, then let's go with the crestas. Crestas is it means the rooster, and it takes the name of this mountain here you see in front of you. You see it has the shape of a rooster, and it takes the shape for the rooster of the chicken. And crestas in Catalan means rooster, the rooster.
Okay, there we are.
Okay. Then you have the wine, the 2018. 2018, as I already explained, very fresh with a lot of rain. As a matter of fact, it was with too much water in many places. But in our case, I mean, the water just drained through the place. We had a lot of rain, and we keep it very, 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 very good quality in our place. Very fresh vintage. Then Las Crestas filling for us. And this is a result of group of friends that is just helping us. Crestas is some sort of a very juicy, easygoing wine. Eh? This is a 80% young Garnacha. Really easy to smell the red fresh fruit. And this is what I call some sort of a coming back home work wine. No? Easy to open the bottle, easy to drink. Just half of glass may go to whatever you are cooking. Eh? And the bottle just may go half of it before you get to the table, really. And very nice freshness. This is what I said, like to say some sort of a wake-up wine. And very much related with this feeling of this wine is the very music that people decided just to join, just to date this wine. Let me show you. 15 seconds. That's about Las Crestas. You have to go on. No way to look back. Go on.
Very nice. It's this fruity, uncomplicated style. It is, it's not a wine where you just have to kneel on the knees to pray at the wine. It's wine for every day.
Es ist immer eine ganz andere Methode, auch einen Wein zu zeigen und zu fühlen und auch in dem Fall zu sehen, weil wir sehen halt die frischen Himbeeren, die Frucht und alles drumherum. Und das macht einfach mehr Spaß vielleicht auch.
Ja.
Das ist mit dem Wein auch gewollt.
Mhm. Ja, diese Verbindung zwischen Frucht, der fröhlichen Musik und die strahlenden Menschen.
Ja.
Es spricht einfach für Lebensfreude.
Ja.
Yeah, I think your choice of pictures was very nice, showing the fruitiness, the happy people, the liveliness.
Yeah, it's also with these pictures here. I mean, when we asked people which were the animals that they were relating with this wine, they were giving us these two animals. I don't know the name in English. No, la ardilla, la jirafa. Very, very nice, easygoing, simpaticos. No, it's as you tell. This is an easygoing wine, very juicy. Even people that do not like wine, it just go on. Eh? It's asking you just to go on. Eh? Mm. It has a 10% Syrah, even sort of a spicy touch at the end, and the wine is just asking you to come back.
I see in the Fiche technique that the wine has been aged for 8 months in second year French oak barrels, but when tasting the wine, I almost don't find any oak.
Thank you. This is for us a key issue. We are just working with French oak wines. Crestas has 8 months of second year. Salanques, it's already 14 months, and Doge is already 16 months of new French oak. And this is because I like to say that we use the wood just to be able to keep the wine longer, okay? And at the end, it depends on the quality and of the grapes you are just using. I mean, when you, in this Crestas, you have a 10% of all Carignana that has the capacity to absorb, I mean, the nice tannin. And the tannin of the fruit, which is coming with the Carignana, is just doing like this with the tannin of the wood. It's just getting very well integrated.
Yeah.
And then you feel the structure because it's sort of a persistency in your mouth, but you don't feel any oakiness, not at all. Eh? It's always in the back, not at the forefront of it.
The oak is rather in the nose that you smell this slightly smoky touch. But I think for me in the mouth, the oak is almost not there.
Yes, yes. It's like this. Easy going.
But it's a wine for a long time. You can drink it now or you can drink it in 10 years, or?
Yes. However, yes, I agree. However, let me put it this way. When you work with young Garnacha, you can keep this wine 10 years and you will get a more, for sure, much rounded wine. But this will not improve in terms of aging. The grape will not really evolve because young Garnacha does not have much things to evolve with. You understand what I mean?
Yes.
Then this is a wine 2018. To enjoy now, to enjoy in 5 years, but I recommend not to keep it to that long. I mean, because you have palanques to be aged longer. You understand? You can keep it, no problem, but don't wait this to become secondary, tertiary aromas, because young Garnacha is Garnacha. Garnacha, as you know, it's very oxidative variety, and when it's young, does not have much, if not any structure, then does not have the conditions to be there too long. You understand?
Yes, okay. Good, fantastic.
You said that Garnacha is bringing in quite some alcohol, and yes, there are also winemakers or people who are fearing alcohol degrees of 17 or 18% and start to pick earlier. But in the end, you always have to balance because you need the ripeness also. How do you manage that?
The key point here, it's balanced. Eh? It's balanced. I mean, this Crestas you are drinking now, it's 14.5. And any of the wines today is 14.5. Any Mas Dois wine is between 14.5 and 15. However, you are going to taste the others. You are not going to feel any heat in your mouth because it has the acidity, it has the freshness just to make the wine completely, absolutely drinkable. We are talking about the acidities of close to 7, okay? I mean, the acidity is coming from the soil because of the old vines, many reasons. We could talk about it because of Poboleda. Many reasons why we have this very nice acidity. In the southern part of the Priorat, you are right, people is just looking very, very closely to the sugar because they do not want to think any going above 14. Yeah? And even some producers, let me put it this way, they are looking for the 13.5 because they think it's okay. But this is already styles of different wines. In my case, I want Mas Dois. Mas Dois is a Mediterranean fresh Priorat wine, but it's Mediterranean. Yeah? I do not try to make a Garnacha de Gredos. They have already Gredos. You understand what I mean?
Yes,
I am in Mediterranean and I have the Schiste Sol. I do not want to avoid that. And I have to show.
Kleiner Hinweis für diejenigen, die Gredos jetzt nicht direkt zuordnen können. Gredos ist eine Region im kassischen Scheidegebirge, auch relativ hoch gelegen, 800 bis 1000, 1100 Metern, wo Garnacha angebaut wird. Da findet man dann auch wieder etwas kühlere Garnachas, leichtere Garnachas, ist so eine Region in Spanien. Es gibt keine eigene DO da, ist teilweise DO Madrid, teilweise, aber viel wird dort einfach als Landwein verkauft. Es gibt super spannende Weine auch, aber von ganz anderen Stil. Also das ist ein ganz anderer Typ von Garnacha, den kann man nicht mit einem Garnacha aus dem Priorat vergleichen. Einfach nochmal, um Gredos zu erklären. Okay.
Kommen wir zum nächsten Wein.
Yes, shall we? Let's move to the next wine.
Okay, let's move to Salanques. Okay, then Salanques. This is it's a completely different wine. Let me put it this way, because we are talking about old vines. Okay, then average in this case is between 60, 70-year-old vines. 65% Garnacha, 25% Carignan. Then here in this case, we are talking about more concentration, lower yields, more concentration. If you have the wine with you, we'll see a much more deeper color. In terms of this is one of the vines with which we do work. Very old Costés, this is slope Costés, with Garnachas and Carignanas within. In those vineyards, we are coming to for the harvest 4 times to give you an idea. We are going in the down part of it just to pick up Garnachas. 2-3 days later, we may go to the upper side for the Garnachas on the upper side. And 2 weeks later, we go with the Carignanas, which are on the downside, and 3 days later for the Carignanas on the upper side. Because now we are just picking everything at the very ripe moment.
Oh, that's again an incredible additional work you have to do to get these results.
Aber damit verhindern Sie auch den Alkoholgehalt zu hoch zu bekommen, weil Sie immer den richtigen Reifezeitpunkt erhielen können damit.
Ja, man geht nicht in die Überreife. Und das merkt man auch, wenn man hier reinriecht. Man hat reife Trauben, man hat reife Beeren, reife Früchte, die man riecht, aber es geht nicht ins Marmeladige. Nicht ins,
Richtig.
We're just talking that the fruit aromas we are having here, we have ripe fruits, but not jammy fruit.
Absolutely, yeah. It's more about black fruit, The Garnacha was more about red, and here you have a more of a balsamic point. Ripe fruit, but not at all. It's not overripe. You get these intense flavor of really sort of a black.
And I think you taste already much more the carinina, yes, with structure, with a grip, yeah, with a texture.
Yeah, the texture here, as you see, is different. As far as you have more carinena, the most important thing is this have these very nice tannins that I guess that you have felt that the wine is just going through your palate more easy than the Garnacha, easy than the Crestas, because this very old carinena is giving a very, very nice tannin that makes the wine just really, it's nice concentration, but with no weight. This is the very nice characteristic about this incredible carinena. You're getting,
yeah,
very powerful wines that do not have any weight. They are not overwhelming you. This is why I call them wake-up wines, because you feel awake. You feel to go on with it. Eh? Unfortunately, some priorats with those overripes, the first glass is okay, but the second glass you have to be seated, no? Because the wine is just sitting down on you, which is just in the other side of our feeling how the wine should go on with you.
Here's the first, more the acid and the freshness on the palate, mm-hmm, in the beginning, the fine tannins and the acid, a little bit the game on my palate.
Yes,
it's nice.
Here you feel how the wine is just going back your ears and is going up your head. That's the Garnacha. That's the voluptuosity of the Garnacha. And on the other side, the Carignana is giving you this verticality. You feel how the wine is just going down, and you feel it. Right? You get the feeling of this.
Talking about this freshness, etc. There's also a very nice question a friend of mine from Austria, Andreas, is bringing in. How important is white wine for Priorat region? I think there's something like 5% or something.
Yes, it's 5%, but a lot of people is planting. We ourselves have been planting white varieties for the last 3 years because it's some sort of it's a nice demand because it's giving a completely different profile of white wine in Spain. Huh? Because you may getting garnachas with nice structures that also has the capacity or not to be aged. But for instance, we have been presenting our first white last year, which is called Murmuri, 95% Garnacha, 5% Macabeo, just fermented in inox with 3 months on its lees, and it has a very nice structure, very fresh, very nice acidity, and is not, let's say, it's a completely different white that people and markets are really attending, and there is demand because it's a different white to the ones you may know in Spain or in the Mediterranean, which are more of a quality.
And especially the people from Germany knowing Riesling as white varietal, which is far more fruit-driven. I personally also love Garnacha Blanca because it's a grape varietal which has a certain creaminess, a smoothness,
but also
a great structure. And like the Red Brother, the Big Brother Garnacha Tinta, you can feel the terroir.
Absolutely. I suggest you to taste the Murmuri and you will be surprised, Pierre, of the very nice freshness, acidity, lightness of the wine, length, grassy. It's really nice. And it's getting more and more important. However, let me put it this way, the Priorat has always been related with red. Eh? That's our main, in my opinion. This will keep the main part of it, but white grapes are keeping and taking their own place. Okay, let's go then with the Salanques. Now here you are tasting 2017 vintage, and look, and here we do not have the Poboleda because it was at the very end of the year 2017 that we get in our town the mechanicals to get the data, no? And up to that 17 it's always average, but here you see the green once again, the average for the last 10 years and 2017, how since mid-January 17 is above the average up to beginning September. I mean the whole year. This, as you may know, was one of the toughest years in Spain with a huge shortage of grapes in many areas because also of the rain. Look at the rain. It was one of the driest years we have ever had. In Priorat, we get 362 liters in the whole year, and one third of it was in October. It was that from January to October, it was 200. And to give you an idea, this year, from January to mid-June, now we are close to 650, just to give you an idea. That's why any picture you look at the period at now, it looks like Switzerland. I mean, we are in the greenest place in the Mediterranean now, which with all the problems that this has incorporated. Okay, let's go then with the 17.
Does this high amount of rain in this year have any sourcing any problems regarding that less mineralic components can be?
No, for the moment, Pierre, just to go straight, we have had, which was not usual, mildew problems in our place, which was not usual. And because even in June, it has been raining 2 out of every 3 days. Eh? I mean, we have never been such affected by that. However, now in the last week, the temperatures have completely changed and everything is drying very, very quickly. And well, we will see. I mean, in principle, this should not have an effect on at the end on the quality, because it begins now. It begins the moment it's always at the very beginning of summertime, when the work of the plant just leaves the leaves and it begins to work with the grape, no? And now this is beginning now. And if we keep good weather now, we can keep it a very good vintage. However, up to the moment that the grape will be within the winery, I'm not going to say anything, because here we have learned that things may change in just 48 hours.
Yeah. Let's go. We have
a question from Mark. The question is, how long you must decant the wine to when you open? How many hours? What do you prefer?
No. It's not a question of hours. Let me put it this way. I mean, the crestas, as far as you have more Carignana, then you may have more time, because Garnacha, as you know, is very oxidative. You open the bottle of Garnacha and you very, very quickly can really smell everything. And as far as you have more Carignana, it's very reductive. It gives you more capacity. I would say if you are going to have a nice long lunch or dinner, let's say 2 or 3 hours, even you can open the bottle, the Salancas bottle, at the very beginning and to go on with the wine for a while. However, if you want to put it on a decanter at 10 o'clock in the morning and to have it for lunch, it's going to be great. I mean, you are going already to have a much more open wine from the very beginning. That's clear.
Okay.
And the suggestion, keep 1/4 or 1/5 of the bottle just for the day after, because these are wines that time just go in favor of them. I mean,
you know, the proper size for a table of two is a magnum bottle.
Yes, absolutely.
If one of the two still has to drive. So, no,
I like it.
Wichtig bei dieser ganzen Geschichte mit Dekantieren ist natürlich auch, dass man überlegt, was für eine Karaffe verwende ich. Wenn ich eine sehr schlanke Karaffe nehme, habe ich wenig Luftzufuhr. Wenn ich natürlich eine Karaffe nehme, die sehr ausladend ist, dann habe ich auch eine sehr große Luftoberfläche. Also auch das, da muss man mitspielen. Ich persönlich finde es immer sehr schön, den Wein zu erleben, wie er sich öffnet. Und insofern lieber kurz vorher dekantieren und dann wirklich im Glas auch selber sehen, wie sich der Wein entwickelt. Und wenn man merkt, okay, der braucht noch Zeit, dann kann man so eine große Karaffe ja auch nehmen und so ein bisschen schwenken, damit er nochmal ein bisschen Luft bekommt. Oder notfalls sagen, okay, diese Karaffe decke ich ab mit einem Zellstofftuch, stelle sie nochmal in den Keller, damit sie kühl bleibt und trinke morgen weiter. Also da muss man einfach... die angetrunkene Erfahrung, sage ich immer so gerne, ist da ganz wichtig. Oder sie macht auch am meisten Spaß, finde ich.
Gut.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, well then, some images about the Salancas. As you see here, it's another story. We have left this party, sort of a big group of friends coming home to see either the Barça or to have a nice risotto. That's Crestas time. Big gathering of people around bottle. And Salancas, it's getting something more intimate. It's more about 4 or 6 people. You already need a nice dish, nice something to eat, more time, a nice glass. And we are talking of this more elegance, more more seductive moments, and for that, for sure, a song like this would help. Give you time to enjoy the wine. Oh.
Even the voice has this slightly smoky aroma, or the smoky touch.
Yeah.
I think
more of a nice texture here. It's more of a velvety texture in your mouth.
Yeah.
It's more about herbs too, violets, and then the Carignana appears. When Carignana is more present, you have more about minerality and more verticality. I like to say that Garnacha is giving more flavors, giving you more fruit. It's more horizontal. It's just going up through your head. Carignana just roots you. Yeah? It's giving you more depth. It's giving you more aging. Yeah? The backbone for the wines to be aged is the Carignana. Yeah? That's where you have the tannins, where you have the acidity. It's giving you the length. It's giving you the capacity to age and the capacity to improve. Okay, I don't want to take more time with you. Let me continue.
Great.
Okay. Then here, I think that I will have to close because this presentation, I saw that the texts are in Catalan and I had the one in English. And I'm gonna to leave the sharing to take the other one, and then I'm coming back in 1 second, okay?
Yep.
We have a question about. We have the question from someone different about Rioja and Priorat, about the wood. Working with wood different from Rioja and Priorat. Valentin?
I think this is a question with.
Sorry, 1 second. I'm looking for. No. I'm just looking for the third wine. 1 second, please. Sorry. Coming back.
I think this is a question. I do understand the question. Der Vergleich zwischen Einsatz vom Holz im Priorat und im Rioja, it's extremely difficult to answer because it is also a question of style. You have very different styles in Rioja, but also im Priorat.
Ich glaube, es hat ja auch viel mit Tradition zu tun. Also Rioja ist viel mehr Tradition, deswegen viel mehr Holz. Verstärkt als jetzt im Priorat, die viel mehr auf diese Eleganz und Feinheiten suchen.
Ja, klar, wenn man jetzt mal in die Geschichte geht, Priorat war ja früher eine Region, die hat einfache Weine produziert, die über den Hafen von Tarragona verschifft worden sind, als Balkweine, als Fassweine.
Fassbar.
Kräftige Weine, die dann irgendwo in Verschnitt gingen, um andere Weine kräftiger zu machen, farbintensiver. Jetzt in der Zeit, in dieser neuen Prioratzeit, da geht es natürlich viel mehr um Eleganz. Das Holz steht im Hintergrund, weil die haben natürlich auch dieses irre Terroir mit dem Schiefer, mit dem Licorella Schiefer.
Okay.
Und das ist etwas, was man natürlich in der Rioja gibt es auch super Terroirs, möchte ich gar nicht bestreiten, aber ist natürlich schon mal was ganz anderes. Und der Einsatz vom Holz, von der Tradition her in der Rioja ist ganz anders.
Can you see now? Can you see the?
Yes. Yeah.
Can you see the presentation?
Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Then now let's go then for the third wine. Is it okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
We love it.
Let's go for Deutsch.
You have Deutsch 2017. Sorry, 2016. And then in
Deutsch. Is it Deutsch or Deutsch?
Deutsch is a Catalan name, is the Catalan of my family in Poboleda. And I wanted to keep the name of Joan Deutsch, who is the man that he passed 2 years ago. He had 75 years when I proposed him to keep the grapes at home. And at that time, he told me, Valentin, I had already given up. I had already given my land to another guy to take care of it. And as a matter of fact, we had to pay that guy just to retake the right to continue working. And since then, he became for sure the very first fan of our wines. And we wanted to keep the name on our wine that has been our flagship from the beginning. And just to explain, the letters of these are taken from the inscriptions that you can find in the Cartusian monastery in Priorat. Is these medieval letters. And with this, we wanted just to keep an homage to the monks that came to our place 1,000 years ago.
Then so here the grapes are older than 100 years old.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Then in this case, what is nice also from the very beginning, you have almost a 50-50% Carignana, 50% Garnacha. More exactly, it's 55 Carignana, 45% Garnacha. And this is one of the vineyards with which we elaborate the Doge. This is a vineyard planted since 1902 and 1903. This is a 110-year-old vine that may give us something between 200 and 250 grams of grapes per vine. It's almost nothing.
You need as you three see, vines for a bottle.
You need 4 to 5 vines for one bottle. Yes. Yes. In the case of Crestas, you need one vine, one bottle. Salanques, you need 2 vines, 1 bottle. And for Doge, it's 3 to 4 vines for one bottle, yes. Then 1902 and 1903, you are talking about 4 or 5 vines. But in this case, it's 3 to 4
And if we see bottle. This picture, it's this is really everything done by hand because there's no machine going through there. It looks very nice and natural.
Well, this picture was taken something like 3 weeks ago. You see the vines, even having these 100 years, are very, very small. They are very clever. They know that they cannot grow, and they have to keep really, really small just to keep this balance and the way to feed the grapes. And on the other hand, here you see a lot of hierbas, because we have been just going through this because the rain has been coming in very, very often.
I see it's very green. Normally, I know the weather in Priorat, but now it's very green.
Wow. And you see the clouds, no? I mean, all these clouds, either the day before or the day after, we're going just to leave some water.
Okay, wow, great.
And this is also, this is another of the vineyards with which we are working, this Mas Dois, is the one that you saw in the middle of the forest, with these very old terraces. And here you see the Montsant. The Montsant is always the north in Priorat. It's always very nice. It's always the north. And then now you are going to taste 2016. In my opinion, 2016 may become one of the best vintages in the last 10 years. Taking as a textbook vintage, you have 2010. And from that point, I think that very good vintages are 2013, 16. And in my opinion, 19 may become also a very good vintage. We'll see. But 2016, if you look at the graph, you see how temperatures were above the average, fresher during from mid-February up to mid-July, and with very good rain. Then we had a very, very rainy spring, rain in terms of average, which give us a very good sprout. And then we had one of the driest summers we have ever had. If you look at all June, July, and August, almost no rain at all, very, very dry. But once again, the long route had the capacity to take. If you see this graph on the right, you see this red line, which means almost a very lack of water for the vines. But we were very lucky because, as you see, beginning September, as we harvest late, beginning September, we had small pieces of rain that completely refreshed the fruit. This was one of the slowest and longest harvests we have ever had. And in my opinion, wines do have an elegance that is really out, really, really, really nice. 2016, in my opinion, may become one of the best vintages we have ever had. Then the Doge feeling, we are getting serious here, my friends. It's about if Crestas was just to have with a lot of friends, it's what I call it's a wine to make friends. Salanques is a wine just to have it with your good friends and to talk about wines. Doge is about having just a 1 to 2 people conversation around the wine. If you are in a hurry, just forget about Doge. You have many other wines. And it's about this, it's also about austerity, about seriousness, about this fire. Carignana is a very austere variety. It's giving us a lot of tannin, nice acidity, but it's not about flavors. It's flavors, it's mainly about the garnacha, no? And then it gives you a lot of length, a lot of backbone just to be there now and later. I don't know if you have already gone through the nose.
What I really like is this fantastic balance between the texture you have, then you have this acidity, which yeah. is appealing, which makes you ask for the next sip, for the next glass, for the next bottle.
Yes, yes.
And
yes.
even if wine has something like 15% of alcohol, you don't feel the alcohol. There's no, yeah. no alcoholic warmth.
Not at all. You feel no alcohol, you feel no acid, you feel no wood, you feel a landscape on your palate, and Absolutely. There's a variety of herbs and fruits and crazy. I like it.
And look how it goes through your palate, even lighter than Salancas.
Long, it's long on the palate. Long time.
So silky in the palate, and then the wine yes. is just going up and going down. You feel how the wine? Let me put it this way, but the wine just begins to drink you. You don't drink the wine because the wine drinks you. You feel yes. how the wine is just feeding you. It's great. It's wow, crazy.
How many bottles you produce from this wine?
It's something between 5,000 and 5,500. It depends. Okay. It depends on the vintage, but it's about this. And we cannot go on because it's the very old vines. I mean, we have been planting, but we will have to wait for a while just to get those grapes, yeah.
So we are very happy to drink one of these 5,000 bottles.
Thank you. And yep. then just to put some serious classical music on it, a classical song just to be enjoyed with this wine.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. As a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping.
This is a wine that asks you already to see what's going on within you.
That was planted in my brain still remains.
I like to say that this wine may be a gift because it's time that you take with your wine, and the wine deserves time. If you are in a hurry, forget about those.
And I like this combination also with the song. It's a sound of silence.
Yes.
Silence is no sound, but it's a sound of silence. You have to look into yourself. You have to hear into yourself to understand the wine.
Yes, yes, Pierre. It's as you said. It's the sound of silence. Sometimes you have to be really quiet just to begin to hear something.
Yeah. You need time. You need time and silence for this
yes.
wine.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. And this, I like to say that this is a wine to be shared with something, someone that should also enjoy the wine. I mean, someone that you should be able to show something going on. I mean, to make some sort of a discovery. It's a sound of silence, as you said. Okay.
I think this is also a very nice way of presenting or talking about wines, just to not describe the aromas, because we're all adults, we know which aromas we're thinking about, but to talk about feelings.
Yeah.
To talk about impressions, empathy,
emotion.
Yes, you are absolutely right. I mean, for us, a wine should transmit emotions, a wine should transmit a place, a wine should make you feel something. I mean, it's we are not talking about wines just to swallow what you have in your mouth. Wines that not only make you to feel something, but then for sure will improve. I mean, I like to say that now you have been going through Cresta, Salancas, Ardoix, all of them, nice acidity, very fresh, very clean wines that gives you very clean mouth just to go on with whatever you are eating. And you are going to enjoy more what you are eating because of the wine. And then the wine will give you the capacity to see, wow, this wine has the capacity not only to clean, but then to remain. No, this is really nice. And then for sure we could go, if we were now, it's more about the aromas, but it's the way you feel it. Eh? It's the way I like to say that, well, the best bottle is the empty bottle. And I like to say that these wines are just giving you the envy to go on drinking and feeling what you feel. And that's nice. That's something special, and that's what we would like to transmit. And then if you ever come to visit us to see our place and you have the capacity to taste these wines in our place, you feel that way. And you feel the rudeness of the Licorella, of this 400 million year soil under which you have your foot. And then you feel rooted. You feel you feel there. That's the point. That's what we can, that we can just give you. Thank you.
Now,
das sind die richtigen Worte zum Abschluss zu sagen, mit dem Blick auf Propeleda von Valentino. Und ich glaube, das hat er sehr gut rübergebracht. Und mal spannend auch für mich und Pierre, mal nicht über irgendwelche Aromen zu reden und welche Speisen und das, sondern einfach mal dieses Feeling und anderes sowas rüberzubringen. Mehr auch die Einfachheit auch und das Erlebnis dafür. Oder Pierre, was sagst du dazu?
Die Einfachheit, das Erlebnis, und ich werde jetzt nochmal das Erlebnis, also zumindest mein Erlebnis, so ein bisschen mit euch teilen. Ich habe am vergangenen Samstag, also vor etlichen Tagen, habe ich eine Flasche 1902, also nicht 1902, sondern 1902, den Centenary Carignan aufgemacht, Jahrgang 2010. Sprich, jetzt 10 Jahre alt, und ich habe immer noch was in der Flasche. Und ich habe ihn über die Tage immer mal wieder verkostet, wenn ich da war. Ich habe es auch schon in meinem Blog kurz beschrieben. I'm just tasting the 1902 from 2010.
Pierre, I mean, that's that's great for you. You are lucky, Pierre, you are lucky.
Yeah. Killing me softly, yeah?
Yes, killing you softly.
Es ist eine von 850 Flaschen, also ist die Flaschennummer 440, aber ich genieße sie wirklich Stück für Stück, und ich muss sagen, es ist, this wine is incredible. You have
this is just 900 bottles beer of a pure Carignana. The point with this is that it was in 2004 when we were just tasting the barrels of Carignana and Garnacha to prepare the blend for the Doge, then we tasting the Carignana, we thought that could be an incredible wine. However, Carignana has never been a variety with which people has been doing big wines or great wines. But we thought it could be. Then for 5 years, 2004, 5, 6, 7, and 8, we just kept 20 bottles of the wine, tasting them. And in 2009, we decided time was ripe just to take 3 barrels and to bottle these 900 bottles. I mean, I don't know which is the number of the bottle you have in your hands, Pierre, but there is number bottles, yes, out of 800 or 900, and pure Carignana. And for us, it's nice because it's a way just to show really one of the limits of this Priorat, no? And this pure Carignana that goes straight. I mean, it's pure freshness, it's pure it's purity, it's about length, it's about concentration without weight. It's just giving you life on giving just going to your blood. I mean, I would like just to be able to put it on.
Yeah, giving me light and pleasure. So it's the bottle number 440.
Nice.
I do have here. And okay.
Out of how many?
Of 850.
Yeah.
Yes.
Three barrels.
It is with only 14% of alcohol, because Carignan has less alcohol than Garnacha.
Absolutely, yes.
It's fantastic. Yes. It's a great wine.
Yes,
I know I have still another bottle in the cellar, different vintage, younger vintage. So I went for this is the second vintage you made of this wine, 2009 and then 2010.
Yes. Well, let me finish, just because the presentation with this. Well, this is a very last image, and then I just close, and then we can see faces. But I wanted to finish with this.
Wow.
We have a question. Carola, yeah. I have a question. How many bottles you produce from Le Crest, Salankes, and Dosh? Dosh, you know, you say 5,000 bottles, and from Crestas?
Crestas, we are close to 40,000, between 40 and 42,000 bottles. Okay. Salankes is about 15,000. Okay. Dosh is about 5,000. And 1902 is 900. And then we have the 1903, which is a pure Garnacha, of which we just may take one barrel, and it's about 300 bottles. Yeah.
Okay.
And then the Murmuri, which is the white, and here we are we are talking about something like 5,000 bottles. Yeah.
Thank you.
I remember I had the chance to taste the 1903, I think last year at Pro Wine.
Yeah.
I was passing, and you just said, "Per, you have to stop. You have to taste this wine," and thank you for doing so. Yeah. It was a fantastic impression.
Okay. Bueno.
Okay.
We have been traveling through the Priorat for a while.
Yes.
Okay. Ich glaube, wir können jetzt hier beenden, und ich glaube, wenn noch Fragen sind, gerne auf Facebook reingehen, oder?
Ja. Klar, Fragen können auf Facebook noch reingegeben werden. Ich habe hier noch eine kurze Umfrage vorbereitet zum Ende des Ganzen, einfach um gerne mal zu hören, welcher Wein für euch die Entdeckung war.
Okay.
Und die spiele ich jetzt ein. Also es geht nicht um den besten Wein, weil das wäre zu einfach, sondern es geht um die Entdeckung. Wir hatten vorhin schon hier im Chat sehr schön, dass der Les Crestes einer der Priorat-Weine mit dem besten Preis-Leistungs-Verhältnis ist. Finde ich eine super spannende Geschichte, weil Priorat hat natürlich eine gewisse Preislage. Ich habe in meiner Zeit, wo ich als Einkäufer gearbeitet habe, auch Priorat verkostet, wo man versuchte, günstig zu sein, aber die Fehlerquote war relativ hoch.
Also, macht keinen Spaß.
Und da kann ich hier genau wirklich zustimmen mit dem Heinrich. Das ist wirklich vom Preis-Leistungs-Verhältnis ist es echt ganz, ganz großes Kino.
Ja.
Dann natürlich jetzt vor allem natürlich für die Profis, ob es darum geht, die Weine ins Sortiment aufzunehmen oder sowas, das interessiert uns natürlich auch. Das interessiert den Valentin natürlich. Insofern, deswegen lasse ich die Umfrage noch ein bisschen laufen. Ich denke, dass wir haben immer noch viele Zuhörer, Zuschauer mit dabei. Natürlich, wenn jetzt der Christoph würde solch eine Frage natürlich mit einem vollen Ja beantworten. Klar, die Weine nehme ich im Sortiment auf. Der Senior Kastner würde es natürlich auch sagen, weil sie sind ja im Sortiment. Aber das sind einfach Sachen, die uns so ein bisschen interessieren. Wie gesagt, das ist etwas, was wir sehen nicht, wer was geantwortet hat, sondern es geht einfach nur dafür, ein Gefühl zu bekommen von dem Ganzen. Und während ich die Umfrage jetzt noch laufen lasse, möchte ich auf jeden Fall mal ein ganz großes Dankeschön sagen, dass ihr jetzt so lange dabei wart, über anderthalb Stunden. Aber ich denke, Valenti hat hier ganz, ganz tief in die Philosophie blicken lassen, hat einfach auch wirklich so ein bisschen diese Idee, nicht nur ein bisschen, sondern hat diese Idee rübergebracht, was dahinter steckt. Es geht nicht darum, ein Wein zu verkaufen, sondern es geht, wie Christoph auch schon sagte, darum, Emotionen, Gefühle weiterzugeben. Einfach das, was das Terroir bietet, in den verschiedenen Stufen. Von einem Einsteiger, von Les Crestes, der einfach eher dieser fröhliche Typ ist, dann über den Salon, der schon eine Struktur hat, bis hin zu einem Mas Deutsch, der wirklich ein weiser Mensch ist. Also das ist natürlich nochmal super spannend zu sehen, sowas aber auch mal auf die emotionale Art und Weise rüberzubringen. Valentin, thank you so much, because this was a way of presentation which is, let's say, more than unusual. We're not talking about hard facts, but more about the feelings and about the emotions. But in the end, we're not talking about an industry product. We are talking about a product from the nature, a product from terroir, a product made by happy people. And we saw all the smiling people from your team. And this is, which also reflects in a certain way in your wines. Sure.
Thank you. But it's as you said, I mean, we know that we are just taking care for a while of this incredible place, and our main idea is just to, and we are happy to be there, and we are happy just to take those grapes and to put it on the bottle and to be able to share it with you. And from this point, for sure, this is a handwork wine. I mean, it's something different for those that would like to share this, the place, the culture. And well, if you ever come and you meet us and you see the place, it's the only thing to be done. And as far as it's the only one, let's do it really perfect.
From a tiny winery.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your time. I hope that, my English is not as well, that I've been easy to understand. I will try to improve my German, which is almost close to zero, for next time.
Oh. But,
I have enjoyed a lot, and I hope that you all have also enjoyed you, Pierre, for your all your comments. Christopher, thank you very much.
It's a great pleasure. I'm
welcome.
Showing the results of the poll. So Salonque was the wine with 50%, which was the coup de cœur, where the people said, wow, that's something seeing.
I have to say that this does not surprise me, because when I have been doing this, if you open the bottles right now and you go on, the one that really is more drinkable on this rather short period and which really impressed you is the Salanques. I agree with this. You really feel a lively white. This is another leak. This is next time. We could organize something with this, really. But with time, with nothing but music and the wine, that's all.
Just tell me when and where. I'll be there.
Okay.
And then it is also very interesting or very nice to see that 50% said this is a wine these wines should be bought again or should be taken into the assortment. This is perfect. And then another 25% say, maybe not all of them, but some of them. So okay. 75%, three quarters.
No, people said no.
Yeah.
So, okay, well, that's good. Thank you very much.
That's good. Thank you
very much. Okay.
So thank you all together. Thank you, Valentin, for taking the time and for making these fantastic wines. Danke, Christoph. Auf der anderen Seite. Und
gerne.
Danke euch allen, die hier dabei wart. Bis ganz bald und stay safe.
Thank you.
See you soon.
Tschüss, Matt, grazie.
Danke. Muchas gracias. Hasta luego.
Wait for you in the Priorat. Come to me.
Yes, we come to you.
Come back.
Thank you.
Ciao. Thank you. Bye.
Gracias.